Welcome to Christ's Clarity once again. I'm sitting here in the shade, but the sun is moving in the sky, and pretty soon it's going to hit me. And I'm saying, wow, I better hurry up here. And it reminds me that right now in the world, we're sitting in the shade of relative stability and prosperity. Even though things are getting worse, we still have a pretty good life. But the ice is getting thin, isn't it? And pretty soon, we won't have that anymore. So what will our riches be going forward? And I tell you, the riches in your life will be your capability that you can take a look at the big picture and listen and consider, contemplate, think about it, casually discuss it, converse about it, have it part of your life. That is real beneficial. Those are true riches. To be able to do that, that's the greatest spiritual practice, is to be able to look at the big picture, to actually do it. Because the very strongest taboo in the world is against this very thing. Interesting, isn't it? Because it's such a simple thing to do. And yet that is the strongest taboo. Why? Because it's effective. Whole purpose of this idea that we chose, the idea of replacing reality with a new reality, is to, the way that it presents itself is insists upon exclusive fixation to this idea, and insists that no other ideas are viable anymore, and therefore it's absolutely taboo to even consider choosing a new idea, even though that's the most simple, obvious thing to do. So this idea is completely vulnerable to simply choosing a new idea. And it doesn't want anyone to know this. That's how it presents itself. That's how it perpetuates itself. It tells you that you must not look here. If you look here, you will be annihilated, you know, forever, eternally. But when you open that door and look behind, all you see is just this very simple realization. Oh, all I have to do is choose a new idea. And there I go. Everything's perfectly fine. That's all that's behind this door. You know, the ego dresses up this door like it's so spooky and dark, terrible. It puts in this frame around the door that is absolutely frightening, with every kind of threat imaginable. And so, of course, nobody opens up that door. It's too frightening. They're scared. But when the door is open, when you open it up, when you are able to realize, look at the frame around the door and realize, nah, none of that is true. It's all a bluff. It's just bluffing. Then you open up the door. What do you see? Ah, so simple, so obvious. It's ridiculously obvious. You just choose a new idea. Existence bothers you. You don't like it. Choose a new idea. That was there all along. That's the secret. The secret is that there is no secret. Okay? That is a fact. What greater place to hide a secret than the fact that there is no secret? We're told that we're supposed to find some secret, and that's keeping us from finding the truth, because the truth is not a secret. The very last thing that would be a secret to us is our natural functioning, which is to choose ideas. And we're looking somewhere else. We're saying, wow, we're looking for something more, something sophisticated. Where is it? We can't find it. So, the simple fact, the simple remedy, is guarded with all these defenses and taboos. And you think, my gosh, what could possibly be behind this door that is so important that it's guarded this way? The defenses are almost impenetrable. You wonder, wow, you're shaking and trembling to open this door. Say, oh my gosh, you know, what is it that's so incredibly valuable? You know, it's so important that we have to guard it like this. My gosh. And then you should realize, oh, just the remembrance of my natural functioning, that I have the power and capacity and authority to choose ideas. I don't like existence, I'll choose a new idea. It's a joke, because what's behind the door is simply is what you are, your functioning, your functionality, remembrance of it. That's it. What could be easier? What could be more obvious to us than our inherent natural functionality that we've always had, but that we tried to get rid of, but failed to get rid of. You see, that's what the defenses are guarding against, because existence has failed to get rid of our natural functioning. It never could, had any authority to do so in the first place. So it was a fait accompli from the very beginning that it would fail. It's always failed. It wants to hide that fact. Because of course, if spirit knows that its functionality is intact, spirit will choose a new idea. There's no question about it. The only way that spirit can continue to have this idea presented to it is if spirit doesn't realize that its functionality is still intact. Spirit has to believe its functionality has been damaged, and it can't choose a new idea, that there are no new ideas to choose in the first place either. All of that has to believe that reality has been damaged or wiped out. It's the only way. Otherwise, spirit immediately would choose a new idea. Spirit would say, this idea of existence is crazy. Don't like it at all. I want to choose a new idea. Boom, it went like that. So, in order to keep this idea viable at all, keep it being experienced, being presented to spirit, it has to present itself like that, like spirit is unaware of its functionality, unaware of it. Somehow it's forgotten. We all know we've forgotten something. What have we forgotten? We're all on the spiritual search trying to remember. Well, there's something really important we've forgotten. I know everybody has this feeling. At some point, they'll have this feeling like, what is that feeling? It's that feeling like I've forgotten some extremely important, vital bit of information. I just can't remember what it is. I have this incredible amnesia. We are suffering from this unbelievable amnesia. You know, an amnesiac is someone maybe who can't remember where their home is, can't remember their name, can't remember their identity. We are suffering from spiritual amnesia. And that is what we're trying to remember. Just simply our functionality, that we can choose a new idea. That's what we're actually trying to remember, and it's completely obvious. And yet we're looking in all the wrong places. You know the song, Looking for Love in All the Wrong Places? Well, we're looking for truth in all the wrong places. We're looking for remembrance for the answer in all the wrong places. So of course we don't find it. And we get frustrated. We think, my gosh, I can't succeed. I can't remember. What is it? Because what we're trying to remember is the most obvious, basic fact of all. That we were created to choose ideas and experience ideas. And we have absolute freedom to do so. That's what we do. This idea of existence is just one small, tiny, crazy idea that we chose on a whim. We're not bound to it at all. We don't have to perpetuate it. We don't have to bring it to some conclusion. We don't have to improve upon it. We don't have to progress, evolve. We don't have to evolve consciousness. That's the one that gets a lot of us. We're supposed to like be evolving consciousness. That's all part of the existence, the false belief we need to do something first before we choose a new idea. So even if we remember, I could choose a new idea, but then we hear this voice telling us, we need to do something first. No, you don't. Nobody does. You don't have to change existence. You don't have to make it nice or good or even bad and unpleasant. You don't need to do any of that. I mean, we want to include here in this casual conversation all types. I've said that there are constructives and destructives. That's the dance of existence, is constructivity and destructivity. And usually we associate spiritual teaching with the constructives, but it need not be at all. Actually, the destructives, they too are looking for the answer. They think they have to do something first before they can choose a new idea. And for them, they believe they need to destroy something first, need to get rid of something first, because they see obstacles in their way that have to be demolished. and they feel their discontent comes from those obstacles, so they're finding a way to destroy those obstacles. But the fact is, they don't have to destroy those obstacles. If you're destructive, you don't have to destroy any obstacle. You don't have to get rid of anything first before you can choose a new idea. You can choose a new idea right now. You could have done it yesterday, or the day before, or a million years ago, or a trillion years ago, whatever. You could do it a trillion years in the future if you want to. Whenever you want to, it's fine. But you never had to do anything in order to somehow make yourself capable of doing so. You've always been capable. Spirit's always been capable, 100% capable. It's just like in a state, almost like feeling like it's paralyzed, like it can't do it. It's frightened itself. Spirit has the capability to frighten itself, which it has done. But none of the fear is actually justified in actuality. It's all false. It's all a bluff. Constructives don't have to go out there and, destroy destructives. Don't have to build some great paradise, utopia. Don't have to do any of that in order to choose a new idea. You don't have to acquire this ability by evolving. The ability is inherently within all aspects of spirit. So nothing has to be done. Nothing has to be accomplished, and nothing has to be not accomplished. In other words, you don't have to stop trying to accomplish anything in order to also have this capacity. You see, this is how we get past the paradox, and this is the speech. This is what's called spiritual speech, non-dual speech. You don't have to do anything first in order to have this capability to choose a new idea. You don't have to stop doing anything first in order to have this capacity. Neither one. Not this, not this. Not that, not that. For instance, if someone is chanting all the time, they say, I need to evolve my capability to chant. I need to do this 3 million times to activate something in order I have to activate my DNA strand so then I can evolve my consciousness and raise my vibration and awareness before I can really be spiritual. Don't have to do any of that in order to choose a new idea. But on the converse, one who's doing all this chanting to raise their vibrations and activate their DNA so they can heighten their awareness, etc., etc., one does not have to stop doing any of that either in order to choose a new idea, in order to have the capacity to choose a new idea. One doesn't have to stop constructivity. One does not have to stop destructivity. And conversely, one does not have to continue constructivity, nor does one have to engage in destructivity. Neither way, neither nor. None of that. Whatever you're doing, you don't have to stop doing it. You don't have to keep doing it in order to be entirely competent to choose a new idea. The competency is inherent, has never been diminished. It's that simple. And some will say, well, I've not evolved enough yet. I need to keep evolving higher. One does not have to evolve at all in order to have this capacity to choose a new idea, because one is spirit. On the other hand, one does not have to stop evolving in order to have this capacity. It's all good. Ultimately, you can say there's no excuses whatsoever. No justifications whatsoever. Not to choose a new idea, not to function as you were created. And it's just a simple, casual conversation about it that makes it obvious. It's the style of doing it that helps make it obvious. Because we're not trying to find some secret anywhere. Because secrets are never obvious, right? Because you get the secret, then you say, well, I got to hide it somewhere so nobody will find it. I got to make it very obscure. So, and then what's the problem is, it becomes obscure to you. You have a hard time finding it again. It's a secret. No need for any of that. No need for that, and no need to stop doing any of that. So just as we are right now, we have full competency to choose a new idea. And we will have that also the next moment and the next moment, eternally. Always be there. We already have that. We're already eternal, eternally competent. Can never be taken away. So what are we doing? Well, we're pretending that we're not eternally competent. Wondering what that's like. So we already know what it's like. Just like this. Every aspect of spirit here is pretending to be incompetent, except those who are no longer pretending. And so, as you come into this world, you're surrounded by an ocean of those pretending to be incompetent. And gradually, you know, it gets into you. Gets into you. And of course, your purpose for coming here usually is to also continue on with that pretense. So it's easy to get into. Now, if you don't really want to do that, it still gets into you. Everybody's pretending to be incompetent in some way. It's incredible. That's what happens here. But they're not. Nobody is incompetent. And they don't have to stop being incompetent. You don't have to change them. Nobody has to be changed. Nothing has to be altered. Everything just the way it is. Right now, this very moment, this very second, has complete competency to choose a new idea, to function as spirit, to function as God created. Every facet. One does not have to believe in the incompetency, this pretense. One does not have to believe in that. One can realize that it's just a pretense and stop believing that it's a fact. And the competency that we're looking for is not worldly competency, like athleticism, like I can run a marathon in 2 hours and 4 minutes or something, or break a world record in this or that, or, you know, be a superstar at work or at play or whatever. We're not looking for that type of competency. That we're looking for the natural competency, the competency to choose a new idea. That's how we really function. And in this world, when you speak of competency, people will say, well, why don't you prove your competency by becoming some superstar? Okay? But see, that's how the world is trying to gain competency. But that's not the competency that we're talking about. The world is trying to get a feeling of competency by accomplishments. The person, accomplishments of the person within existence. But all the while remaining fixated on this one idea. And that's what gives the feeling of incompetency. Spirit feels incompetent because it's not functioning the way it was created to function. So it doesn't matter. You could be the greatest superhero of all superheroes. You could be Superman, all superheroes wrapped into one, saving everybody from all tall buildings, burning buildings, and evil machinations of the bad guys, you know. And you could be the absolute superhero of the entire universe, able to do every single miracle imaginable, saving planets right and left. You do that before breakfast. And that still will not get rid of the feeling of incompetency that you have. At all. In fact, it would become overwhelming because you realize, I'm saving the whole universe. You know, I've discovered a cure for everything in the universe. I'm this unbelievably great, competent being who can do all of this, and yet still I feel completely incompetent. Because competency for us comes from functioning as we were created to function, and we were created to function as one that which chooses ideas from the infinite ocean of ideas that the Prime Creator presents, and we swim through these ideas like fish, weaving this incredibly rich tapestry of experiencing through these all these ideas, and we've forgotten these ideas. We don't even know what they are, because we've decided just to hold on to one to the exclusion of all others. And that brings a feeling of incompetence to us. We're not functioning the way we're supposed to, and that we have no control over this feeling. It's inherent within us. When we try to change our functionality, we are going to feel not going to feel right. That's a fact. And like I said, it doesn't matter if you're the superhero of all superheroes, you will still feel exactly the same feeling of incompetency as some poor, lowly, indentured servant slaving away on some potato farm somewhere, whatever. They'll have the feeling, too, of that incompetence. Doesn't matter what you do, what station of life you're in, how rich you are, how poor you are, what your social status or lack of status is, all suffer from the same feeling of incompetency. And yet we pretend, oh no, you know, the rich, the well-off, the superheroes, no, they feel competent, they must feel competent. So I tell you that it is those who are high up, supposedly, on the totem pole of existence, they really have a struggle, because they think, oh gee, I'm supposed to feel competent, and I don't. They feel like frauds. I'll tell you the truth. You think all those superstars and celebrities feel wonderful all the time because we were adoring them, saying, look how competent they are, look how great actors and actresses they are, and singers and dancers and you name it, you know, they're so competent. And the people inside themselves, they feel, my gosh, I don't feel competent at all. I have this terrible feeling of incompetence, and yet everybody adores and looks up to me and worships me and says, wow, you're the greatest, you're so competent. And they feel like such total frauds. That's a fact. Terrible position to be in. It's better to be in a lowly position where everybody thinks you're just a nobody from nowhere. That's the position that I'm in. It's better. Everyone looks at you and say, they say, ah, that one is incompetent. Incompetent. And you'll say, yeah, actually, I do feel incompetent. You see, I'm so incompetent there that I even forgot to turn off my phone while I was taping. And if others are not looking at you as some super competent entity, then you don't feel like such a fraud, you know. It's easier. And then you can begin focusing not on trying to protect this image of competency that you have to the world, but more on, why do I feel incompetent, and what's the real solution? It's very difficult when you have an image to protect, an image of competency to the world. Spiritual path is very difficult. So it's usually those who are very lowly, who nobody suspects at all. There's, that one's incompetent. They're able to examine the big picture like this much more effectively. So don't strive to be a superstar in the eyes of the world. And don't envy those who are. Have pity on them, actually. It's a terrible position to be in. Some say that Elvis faked his own death and actually is living incognito somewhere. That's kind of an apocryphal type of statement that points out to a greater truth, that fame and fortune, really the celebrities, they want to escape it. They really do. And if they could fake their own death and disappear and go incognito somewhere, a lot of them would, actually. A lot of them would. And after experience of fame and fortune, the feeling is, man, that was crazy. I don't want to experience that again, ever. Waste of time. I wasted all that time. It's nonsense. I still feel incompetent. You know, let's get down to serious business now. Forget about that glitz and glamour and tinsel. The world's being sold on that right now. You know, false feeling of competency. The people who are marketing this, they're being used, and they live very difficult lives, and they're unhappy. It's a waste of time for them, really. And we might consider that the great gurus and teachers and saints and avatars, etc., they found a sense of competency in the world somehow. They learned to be loving. They learned to be compassionate or nurturing, and then they feel competent. No, that's not true at all either. What they found out was there is no way to feel competent with the idea of trying to replace reality with a new reality. It's impossible to feel competent with that because it demands exclusive fixation to one idea. So what they realized, what they did was they chose another idea. And that restored this feeling, I'm competent, I can choose other ideas. I'm free to choose other ideas. That's where they got it, you see. Now should the rich stop being rich and become poor? Should the sophisticated turn into the savages and all of that? No, because in poverty, you still feel incompetent. The noble savage still feels incompetent. You go to some island somewhere in the jungle, you will still feel incompetent. It's a waste of time to think that you can find it somewhere else in existence, some time and place or some event in time and space, that you're going to find it by changing your position in life. You won't find it. But I would say that celebrity is something not to be sought. That does cause problems when everyone is believing that you are competent, that somehow your competency is a light to them, you see. And then you feel like you don't want to let anybody down, but you have to keep playing this role of pretense. That's not a good situation to be in. Very few celebrities quit and say, forget it. I remember one, Rosa Poncel, the great diva, operatic singer, at the very height of her abilities, when she was still quite young, actually, she just said, that's it, forget it. That's enough. I've done enough. I'm tired of this, all of this. I quit. And she quit and never went back. That's it. She never really sang again. Amazing. So rare for that to happen. Arguably the greatest singer of all time simply just turned from it and said, I don't need to sing anymore. This celebrity thing, this whole thing, is just, I don't want it. So something in her just was able to do that. Amazingly beneficial. And she lived a very obscure life, very humble, pretty obscure life in a mansion. Sure, she still had her tastes, etc. But she was no longer the celebrity. She faded from the stage. Most try to cling to that because they want the adulation. They want people telling them that they're so competent. You know, perhaps Poncel was the most competent singer ever. And yet she said, I don't need people telling me how competent I am. Forget it. It's not worth it. It just doesn't mean anything to me, really. It would be a great thing if more could realize that. Now, of course, she had the money to quit. But most celebrities do have the money. How much money do you need, really? How many hundreds of millions of dollars are necessary? I mean, isn't it possible just to say, forget it? This is not serving me well because I'm being trapped by others' expectations of me, and I feel like I'm a fraud, I'm a pretense, I'm pretending that I'm competent, that I have the way to competency is through me, and I'm showing people the way, and I know I'm not. I feel the sense of fraudulence. But do I really have to make more and more millions, more and more mansions? Keep the huge flow of money coming in? That's a question that should be asked. And hopefully people say, you know what, I don't have to. Forget it. I have enough. Let me fade from the stage. Let the spotlight go away from me now. I want to focus on getting the real answers right now. Because I know this isn't it. My antics aren't it. You know what? If you're going to be a diva, then be a diva all the way. The true diva can walk away from it all. You know, the diva says, I want it this way, I want it that way. But the real top diva says, you know what? That's it. Enough's enough. I say I don't want to do it anymore. That's it. That's the real diva. No need to hang on. I've proven everything I need to prove. Forget it. I don't have to prove anything more. I want to sober up now and get down to really see the big picture and where competency really is. And who knows that better than the ones who are seen as extremely competent in something, you know, the virtuosos. They know that they had a capability to do certain things better than anyone else, and yet they still feel completely incompetent. So they know very well that it's useless to continue to pursue excellence in existence. It's useless. Exceptionalism is useless. I know the mantra of the United States, for instance, is exceptionalism. That's what we're taught here. We're brought up here. I was brought up that way. Very much so. We were all completely indoctrinated into the idea of exceptionalism. You have to be absolutely exceptional. And what greater trap is there than that? No one needs to be exceptional. Why? Because we already are spirit, which is the very definition of exceptional. We're already that. We don't have anything to prove. Do we have to prove that we're spirit? No, we don't. But we do have to function as spirit. And if we're not functioning as we were created to function, we won't feel the way we're supposed to feel. We'll feel like there's a hole in us. We're lacking something. Something isn't right. No matter if we're the greatest virtuoso that ever took the stage, still feel that. And the greatest virtuoso ever took the stage, they find that out. They say, my gosh, I can sing like nobody else has ever sung, and yet I still have this hole in my heart. Something's wrong. I'm missing something. I'm lacking something. And they say, oh, wow. And the truth is that when they're born again, reincarnated again, they don't pursue virtuosity like that. They say, ah, forget it. That's not the answer. That's not the answer. Let me be quiet, humble, nobody from Nowheresville. And let's take a closer look at all this and find out what the answer really is. What's really wrong? Why do I feel this lack? How come I cannot cure this feeling I have of incompetency? I thought I cured it by having the world worship me as a diva or something, and now I realize that it didn't cure it at all. So what do I do now? Get serious. Casual conversation about the big picture. Clarify. Realize that the facts are that we feel this incompetency because we're fixated on one idea to the exclusion of all others. The only way to cure that incompetency is to choose a new idea. And then you'll say, ah, I can do it. I really am competent. Truly competent. I don't need to be a diva anymore. What a relief. I don't need to be a superstar anymore. What a relief. I don't need to be the great actor or actress. What a relief. I don't need to be the funny man, the comedian, the one with all the antics. I don't have to cure all the diseases and sicknesses there ever is or will be. I don't have to do any of that. What a relief. And that's the relief that we have in store for us when we decide to choose a new idea. Decisions at the level of spirit, the spirit that chooses it. We can't force this choice mentally, we can't force it physically, emotionally, we can't force it. But we can become familiar and casual about it, so it's part of our daily consideration, and we get used to the idea, and eventually it'll just be so, yeah, of course, that's what we'll do. Yes, and then we will do it. We will do it. Okay, very good. Much clarity to everyone, always. That's it.